Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Maria Endres, and on behalf of Lung Foundation Australia, I'd like to welcome you to our second installment of our Ask an Expert webinar series on silica dust, respiratory protective equipment, and silica dust. Through this virtual meeting place, today we are gathering from many parts of Australia. For myself here today, I join you from the lands of the Yagara and Turrbal peoples here in Meanjin or Brisbane, and I pay my respects to elders both past and present and acknowledge that this land was never ceded. As part of National Safe Work Month and Lung Foundation Australia's National Silicosis Prevention and Awareness Campaign, we are hosting our Ask an Expert webinar series. Our expert panelist is here today to dive into the world of respiratory protective equipment. Before we begin, just some very brief housekeeping. Firstly, today's webinar will be recorded and made available via our website so it can be viewed online at a later date if you can't stay for the whole duration. You'll also be notified by email once you registered with the recording when it is available. Secondly, a Q&A session will be held towards the end of the webinar, so please feel free to submit your questions via the Q&A box at the bottom of the toolbar at the screen throughout the presentation. Just please keep questions to a general nature as individual specific advice cannot be provided. And today I am very excited to welcome our brilliant expert panelist, Mark Rudgers. Mark is a certified occupational hygienist whose current specialist application engineering role at 3M Australia in the personal safety division focuses on providing technical end user guidance and advice around the selection, use, and maintenance of respiratory protective equipment. Mark has over 20 years in the safety equipment and training industry. He's passionate about respiratory protection to ensure workers' health is not compromised from workplace exposures as part of a workplace's control strategy. He's a current member of the SF010 Respiratory Protection, ISO-TC 94SC15 Respiratory Protection, and SF006I and Phase Protection Australian Standard Committees. Mark is the chair of the RESFITS, which is a respiratory fit testing training and accreditation program run by the Australian Institute of Occupational Hygienists. Mark, we are so pleased to have your expertise in the room today. So without further ado, I will hand over to you.
Well, yes, thank you everyone for attending today. And hopefully you get some information that you can apply in your workplace, at home, or be able to share with others when we start thinking about, you know, silica, respiratory protection in general as well. So just to start off from a disclaimer, I'm here today representing the AIOH and RESFIT, and certainly we're going to be showing a range of different products in the presentation today. But just wanted to highlight that that is not an endorsement, and the principles that we are talking about apply to all different brands of respiratory protection as well. Just trying to hide some screens here. Applies to any brand of respirator that you may be using. The principles do apply as well. So without further ado, let's get into some of the content. And something I always start off my training presentations with is just to start with the hierarchy of control. And I'm sure many of you are aware about the hierarchy of control, a very common concept that is used in workplaces all around the world, and certainly agree 1000% that PPE certainly is at the bottom of the hierarchy when we think about things that workplaces should be looking at from the top down to PPE. But I guess the point I usually try and start with is to put this in context, that if PPE is being used, that we have our control strategy and we are using a range of different strategies and controls, if it's required, it's no less important than any one of the other controls that needs to be in place. If it is required, it really, you can maybe counter argue to say, well, it also becomes the one we need to put the most focus on, because it is that, you know, last line of defense, a very common term that I'm sure many of you have heard that saying before, but it is that last line. So we really need to put in effort, often more effort and ongoing effort as far as when we start talking about PPE, and broadly, because that effectiveness of PPE comes down to that the human interaction. We're relying on behaviors for individuals to do, but obviously giving the right information so they know what to do is obviously a critical step as well. So I just want to, you know, highlight the fact we are talking about PPE. It is the bottom of the hierarchy, but if it's needed, it's no less important than any one of the other controls. the other thing I also like to sort of say, and you're all welcome to borrow any of my sayings or analogies I use quite often in my training, is, you know, what does that first P of PPE stand for? Personal protective equipment. And sometimes that maybe, you know, gets lost in the scheme of things, where we're thinking about it's personal, it's got to be right for the person. You know, we think about when we get into fit and size and shape, lots of different types of PPE. It's going to be right for the person, but also relies on the person, the individual wearing it, to do the right things, know how to use it and wear it for that effectiveness to be there. So when we look at achieving protection, when we think about respiratory protection, this concept applies to all different types of PPE, as much as we're zoning in on respiratory protection today, is that first point of, is the PPE adequate? Is it suitable? And will it be worn? So I'm going to use this terminology a little bit about, is the PPE adequate and is the PPE suitable? So when we think about adequate, let's, you know, we're going to be talking, obviously we're zoning in on silica and respiratory protection. Is the PPE for the respirator right for the hazard and reduces the exposures to the expected level, which we're going to talk about today. So we can have lots of different types of respirators, and we'll touch on some of the high level things about different types of respirators. Disposable, reusable half face, we've got full face, we have powered air purifying respirators. All of those can be adequate, but not all of those will necessarily be suitable. So this is when we think about suitable for the individual, suitable for the task, suitable for the application. Is it a task that we're doing, where we're drilling something? Is it a short job? So using a disposable for a short period of time can be very well suitable. But maybe if it's a task or constant exposure over 6, 7, 8 hours, 12 hours, depending on the shift and the context of the application, is that disposable going to be the most suitable? We look at other types of respirators, such as a PAPR from a comfort, wear, time point of view, thinking about the impact on communication, the fit aspects as well. So thinking about the individual characteristics of what are you doing, how long are you doing it for? So lots of respirators may be adequate, but only, you know, a couple may be the most suitable for what you're doing. And obviously that suitability will vary depending on what is being done, which links into ultimately comes back to that human behavior. Will the PPE be worn? How do we make sure through that selection process, you know, addressing those suitable points, that has been worn and worn properly each and every time that it's needed. And this comes back to that link of, we need all these things in place for protection to be there, or have an expectation, a reliable expectation that protection is going to be there. And that's, as we're talking about respirators today, but from a broad PPE point of view, the same high level concept works, whether it's, you know, hearing protection, is it appropriate for the noise level, you know, attenuation, is it the right type of gloves for the chemicals that you're doing, is it suitable for the task that you're doing, length of time that you're doing. So spend a little bit of time just highlighting to think about that high level, you know, all the things we go through. Is it adequate, is it suitable, and obviously we need it to be worn. So probably a good starting point, we're talking about respiratory protections, maybe start with what is not a respirator. So we've got a couple of pictures up on the screen there that are not respirators. We think about, you know, respiratory protection or products that are tested, intended to provide protection from an inhalation point of view. Certainly we've got a surgical mask there that is a piece of PPE, but not a respirator. Certainly it's a surgical mask preventing things from going out from a wearer, and a barrier from, you know, bodily fluids, blood, from a healthcare setting point of view. Certainly got coverings. Also, if you get your, you know, a cleaning scrubber from the kitchen sink and put that on as a respirator, that is also not a respirator as well. So just highlighting, you know, what are not respirators as far as what are made, intended, and rated to. Certainly also hopefully have start off with the lighter side of things, thinking about what the world has been through with the last couple of years with the pandemic and being in the respirator space of things. I certainly paid attention and took note of the different attempts of face coverings and respirators throughout the pandemic. And certainly thinking about what we all went through, you know, well, obviously these individuals across the world have certainly acknowledged that there's a risk, you know, there's a hazard and we're trying to do things. But as far as the effectiveness and reliability of these different types of PPE, certainly I would question, despite the best intentions, attempts to protect themselves, acknowledging, hey, in that context, from a pandemic context, is obviously those, you know, aerosols, COVID-19 from that point of view. So certainly lots of attempts, but I wouldn't say are going to be incredibly effective. So when we look at respiratory protection, what do respirators do? And a really important point that I always try and start off with is just the concept that respirators do not eliminate exposure. It is not a magic bubble that goes on your head, on your face, over your nose and mouth that eliminates exposure. Respiratory protection is all about reducing exposure from a hazardous level down to an acceptable level. And that acceptable level, you know, we reference the workplace exposure standards that we'll talk about. So this is where it is, there's going to be some amount getting in, but through the right selection and controls, it's going to be an acceptable level in that context. So respirators do not eliminate exposure. So when we start looking about, you know, respiratory selection, and obviously we're zoning in on silica and particulates today, but the same, you know, concepts apply, whatever that airborne hazard may be. And thinking about selection is a crucial part of an overall respiratory protection program, which the Australian Standard 1715 does highlight. And in the next slide, we'll look at some of those key points. But I just want to highlight that, you know, selection is one part of the overall program. If you're focusing in on purely the selection, you're going to miss some really important elements that are also critical when we think about, you know, people, the impact of respirators. So you can see that you've got medical screening as their pre-existing conditions. You know, thinking about respirators, maybe a sense of claustrophobia, putting something on your face, you know, they're the kind of things that we, you know, as a workplace, as an individual responsible is to know that before, you know, we're putting a respirator on an individual and putting them out in an environment, what is that impact? Thinking about there is a physiological impact. We're having to draw air through a filter or physically have something on there. So like I said, we've only got a short time today, but just wanted to highlight that, you know, we're talking about selection in the context of a respiratory protection program. Which we'll get into fit testing a little bit today, but obviously that disposal, the record keeping and that evaluation, like any kind of system or program, needs to be evaluated. And how can we continuously improve those outcomes and the objectives of the system, the respiratory protection program in this case. So starting off from a respiratory selection point of view, whatever the hazard may be, identifying the hazard is the key first question. When I get phone calls, you know, with my day job or, you know, through RESFIT, you know, I'm doing this particular task, my first thought is, well, what do you need protection from? And so we've got particulates, gases and vapors in oxygen deficient environments. Particulates is, you know, a range of different types of things, as you can see there on the screen, dust, fibers, mist, fume, biological aerosols, they all fall under this category of particulates. So when we start thinking about silica, and silica dust absolutely falls under that particulate range of things. Maybe not something you've thought about, but thinking about, why has it been a P2 recommended or maybe an N95 for silica? And also thinking about COVID or maybe diesel particulate matter or maybe welding fume, all these range of airborne hazards. We'll look at why that is the case and how a particulate filter works. Then we have gases and vapors. So certainly lots of workplaces will have exposures to different contaminants, solvents as an example. Maybe, thinking about chlorine in aquatic environments is just one that popped off the top of my head. And then certainly oxygen deficient environments that these respirators aren't providing oxygen. So understanding what is the hazard that we need to protect our worker from or individually is a key first question as far as our respirator selection point of view. This is a short little video that is not, it's one that I've actually taken off YouTube that came off early in the pandemic. And it goes through how particulate filters work. And I hope that you'll find it particularly interesting. But when we talk about, you know, how do these filters work? Why are they so effective at filtering, you know, particulates? And obviously silica as one particular contaminant of concern that was, we're zoning in on today. Hopefully you'll find this interesting and maybe a newfound appreciation for all these different products that you've been wearing or what's out there and available and why they work so well from a filtration point of view. So if you can't hear this, let me know, but I tick the box, so here we go.
Prior to March 2020, there's a good chance you didn't know what an N95 mask was, or at least didn't think about them unless you were doing a home repair project with lots of dust or live in a part of the world with crazy pollution or wildfire smoke. And upon learning about them, you might think, like I did, that an N95 mask is basically a really, really fine strainer, a mesh of fibers with gaps too small for dust and other airborne particles to get through. A strainer filters out particles larger than its openings, but not particles smaller than its openings. So you'd expect that with a mask, after a certain point, small enough particles will sneak through. But this isn't how N95 masks work. The particles they filter are generally much smaller than the gaps between the fibers in the mask. What's more, an N95 mask is actually really good at filtering both the largest and smallest small particles. It's medium-sized small particles that are hardest for it to block. This isn't at all like a strainer, because N95s are much cleverer than strainers. The overarching goal of an N95 mask is instead to get an airborne particle to touch a fiber in the mask. Regardless of how big an airborne particle is, once it touches a fiber, it stays stuck to it and doesn't become airborne again. This isn't anything special about the fibers, but about the size of the particles. At a microscopic scale, everything is sticky, because the weakly attractive force between molecules is more than strong enough to hold very, very small things in place. So you shouldn't think of N95 masks like a fine window screen that keeps insects of a certain size out. You should think of them more like a sticky spider web that can catch an insect of any size, as long as it touches a strand. And so N95 masks use a bunch of different clever physics and mechanical tricks to get particles to touch their fibers. First, many spider webs are better than one. Unlike strainers, where stacking many identical ones doesn't improve the filtering at all, more layers of sticky fibers means more chances for particles to get stuck. And how likely particles are to hit or miss a fiber depends in large part on their size. Airborne particles larger than 1/1000 of a millimeter basically travel in straight lines because of their inertia. And because there are so many layers of fibers, their straight line paths are essentially guaranteed to hit a fiber and stick. Airborne particles that are really, really small are so light that collisions with air molecules literally bounce them around, so they move in a random zigzag pattern known as Brownian motion. This zigzagging also makes it super likely that a particle will bump into a fiber and get stuck. Particles of in-between sizes are the hardest to filter. That's because they don't travel in straight lines, and they also don't bounce around randomly. Instead, they're carried along with the air as it flows around fibers, meaning they're likely to get carried past fibers and sneak through even a mask with many layers. But N95 masks have a final trick up their sleeve. They can attract particles of all sizes to them using an electric field. In the presence of an electric field, even neutral particles develop an internal electrical imbalance which attracts them to the source of the field. This is why neutrally charged styrofoam sticks to a cat whose fur has been charged with static electricity. But unlike a cat's fur, an N95 mask's electric field isn't just ordinary static electricity. The fibers are like permanent magnets, but for electricity. Electrets. Just like you can permanently magnetize a piece of iron by putting it in a strong enough magnetic field, you can electretize a piece of plastic to give it a permanent electric field. By electretizing the fibers in an N95 mask, they gain a long-lasting ability to attract particles, which means they capture about 10 times as many particles as regular fibers. And this is, after all, the point of an N95 mask, to filter out particles from the air, and they do it cleverly. By taking advantage of the molecular scale stickiness of matter, using many layers of fibers that catch straight moving large particles as well as zigzagging small particles, and having an electric field that attracts all particles, you get a mask, not a strainer, that's really good at trapping both large and small airborne particles, and does a reasonably good job at filtering out middle-sized airborne particles. Precisely what fraction of those sneaky medium-sized particles get blocked gives you the number of the mask. If at least 95% of those particles are filtered out, then the mask is rated N95.
I hope you found that interesting. I know my day role, so to speak, working for a respirator manufacturer, now it is a common question. How small of a particulate can your filters, your products, or any product on the market filter down to? So hopefully with that video, you get an appreciation. The right question isn't necessarily what's the smallest size, but what's the hardest particle size to capture, that in-between size that does align. So when we think about our Australian standards filters rating, so, you know, talk about N95, when we think of it from an Australian standards point of view, P1 is at least 80% of that hardest particle size, P2, 94%, and P3, 99.95% of that hardest particle size to capture. And what you're seeing on the screen there is an actual one layer of a filter, of a P2 filter there, trying to get that visualization about, you know, the torturous path of particulate, this piece of silica or silica dust has to actually go through to work its way through the filter. And with that video understanding, hence why they perform so well and very well understood from that filtration point of view. So, and this is what we'll get into talking about fit where, you know, from a filter capture point of view, like, it's very well understood and works very well. You know, when you talk about rated products that meet the standard that you can get your hands on in Australia as well. So hopefully you look at a P2 or P3 or P1 respirator and visualize this kind of, I often will call it a sticky bowl of spaghetti with that visualization of, how it's got to get through. Now, the next common question I do get asked, and many of those with RestFit and fit testers, well, all right, I've got this particulate filter. How long will it last? When do I change my filter? And it's a very obvious and good question that you should be thinking about when you're having to wear a respirator. That first point there, when we think about this visualization, the most common, I guess, rule of thumb is when there's unacceptable breathing resistance to airflow or to the wearer. Now, we think about our sticky bowl of spaghetti analogy and the pictures that we've just seen. So as that filter gets clogged up and more dust gets pulled through as we're working and breathing through, or a PAP is pulling it through a filter, it actually becomes a better filter because it comes, you know, those gaps between the fibers get smaller and smaller as that filter loads up. So it's great in the fact that we don't lose protection as it gets more clogged up. But at some point, to the individual, to the wearer, it's going to be, gee, I'm really struggling to draw air through comfortably. Hey, I need to get another filter. Thinking about reusable respirators, or maybe from a disposable or filtering face piece point of view, maybe a case where you've been wearing it all day and it's hot and sweaty. So more from a hygiene, you know, the straps have been stretched. Certainly if there's any physical damage, maybe an environment, if you think about healthcare, it may be change every patient. So there's a few different rules of thumb depending on the application and the use. And certainly there's shelf life on these types of products to not use past the shelf life, but appreciating that breathing resistance is going to be that most common indicator, certainly for those reusable respirators. So when we think about, there we go, click through, the range of different types of respirators that certainly are rated and tested to Australian standards 17, 16. This is, I like to call, the family tree of types of respirators. On one side, we have our air purifying respiratory protection, and probably the most common ones that are out there as far as when people think about respirators. So when we think about air purifying respirators from a group point of view, is that it uses a filter or a cartridge to capture the contaminant. So when we're thinking about silica, we've got a particulate filter that the air that we're breathing is being drawn through, and those contaminants are getting caught in that filter, as we've just went through as well. We talk about negative pressure for the three on the side there, because inside the respirator, when you're breathing, working hard, we're creating a negative pressure inside the respirator as we're breathing in. And depending on what you're doing, that could be quite a physical task or a high work rate, high breathing rate. It's going to put a lot of negative pressure or pressure on that seal. And then we've got our PAPRs, or power air purifying. So similarly, these types of products that you're seeing there, that they have a filter as well, but it's a fan or motor or blower drawing the air through that filter. So there's no increased breathing resistance for the wearer of a PAPR. You know, the machine's doing that hard work as far as drawing the air through the filter. And certainly, you know, all the, you know, current units, you know, will have an indicator when that's becoming too much for the unit to maintain the airflow that it needs to maintain respiratory protection as well. But in principle, still having air drawn through a filter to capture the contaminant. And I guess highlighting, as we went back to that adequate and suitable, each of these different types of products have, you know, pros and cons depending on what you're doing, how you're doing it, how long you're doing it for. So certainly they're the kind of things we think about a selection point of view, is talking to the people that you're getting your PPE from, talking to the manufacturers of PPE that you're involved with, to find out about, you know, the products and is it going to suit your situation. Thinking about that suitability aspect of respiratory selection as well. On the other side of the family tree there, we've got supplied air or atmosphere supplying, where we've got a source of air being provided to the wearer external to, or not relying on the immediate in environment that the person's in. It's an SCBA there, or escape types of sets as well. So we think about these air purifying respirators as very commonly used in lots of different applications that are out there. You know, it is for environments where we know what the contaminants are. You know, that selection, what is that airborne hazard, and the suitable filters are available, and certainly not for environments where it's, you know, an IDLH, commonly associated with gas and vapors. If it's an oxygen deficient environment, you know, those types of air purifying respirators are not providing oxygen to the wearer as well. So once again, understanding where they suitably used and where the situations where it's not going to be suitable to use. So that's where, like I said, talking to the people you're getting your PPE from, engaging the right people, could be occupational hygienists, could be health and safety people with experience in this area to get that information of what is or isn't suitable for what you may be doing. When we think about tight fitting respirator performance, so they're the types of respirators you're seeing pictured in the center there that rely on that tight fit or that seal around the wearer's face to prevent those contaminants coming in. So three key things that need to be present when we think about high level things that need to be there, and sort of bring them up on the screen here, that it needs to be worn. Compliance, I know that seems pretty obvious, but I know I've been in plenty of circumstances where people have left it in the work truck, the vehicle, the PPE cupboard. It's got to be worn. It's got to be the right filter for the contaminant that we're working with. And then fit. It needs to fit the person. It needs to be worn correctly. And we're going to get into that a little bit as well. So we look at this situation here in this particular picture. That, you know, he's got it on, he's got the right filter for the dust that was blowing down the street, but certainly, you know, hopefully it's fairly obvious that we've got a little bit of an issue with the fit side of things. We've got it on sideways, we've got it sort of a gap off the side of his face, and certainly we've got some facial hair there, which we'll talk about has an impact. But just highlighting, you know, we need these three things to be in place. It's not trying to have a go at this individual, but just highlighting the point that, you know, we shouldn't just be giving a respirator, you shouldn't be given a respirator without any information, instruction on what to do. You know, fitting a respirator is not hard, but certainly knowing which way that it goes up and a few simple things goes a long way from a situation, unfortunately, very extreme like this, to having confidence that, you know, what you're wearing is suitable and you're achieving that protection that is required to protect yourself. So when we think of these different types of respirators in our big family tree, they're grouped together by their what we call our respiratory protection factors. So what is the amount of reduction that respirator is expected to provide from outside the respirator to inside the respirator? Remember the star we said it doesn't eliminate exposures, but it's about reducing exposures. So CO is concentration outside and CI is concentration inside. So as you can see by the little example there, if we've got 20 furry particles floating on the outside and two's getting in, however they're getting in, we're having a protection factor of 10 or a 10 times reduction of exposure from outside the respirator to inside the respirator. So just to get an appreciation of the concept, and what you're seeing here on the screen now, as it hopefully comes up for you, is the Australian standard groups different respirator combinations of the types of filters, positive pressure, negative pressure, supplied air purifying, and gives them a protection factor. And I guess the concept I want you to take away from this slide, this couple is here, is that the higher the exposure, you know, over the exposure standard, the greater the reduction exposure is required to bring that down to an acceptable level. At an absolute minimum, that's going to be going down to the workplace exposure standard, but ideally well underneath that. So it's not about remembering for yourselves, but just that concept of the higher your exposure, the greater the reduction that is required. And just highlighting here, for those that may, you know, depending on your background, is, you know, appreciating the lower of the exposure standard. What impact does it actually have on respiratory selection? So it was at, you know, 0.1 milligram per cubic meter a couple of years ago. We're currently at 0.05, and, you know, very likely potential in years to come dropping down even further. But what this slide is trying to highlight is that maybe, you know, your exposure was at 0.6 milligram per cubic meter as an example. So in the old exposure standard, you'd be, you know, a 10 times reduction would bring you underneath that 0.1. But now a 0.6 exposure, a 10 times reduction is not going to bring you down enough. So you need to select a respirator combination that's going to bring us down underneath that 10. And as that exposure standard drops lower, and that's why this concept works on whatever the airborne hazard is, thinking about diesel particulate matter, welding fume, you know, whatever those types of airborne hazards are that you've got in your workplace. Now we're using that exposure standard as that guide is in the lower the exposure standard, 10 times, 50 times is going to be a lot lower number. But like I said, I don't want to try and throw too much at you, but just an appreciation of reducing that exposure to an acceptable level. And this is this suitability aspect I touched on at the start. You know, we could have a P2 on a reusable half face that is adequate for, you know, a task that you're cutting concrete in that regard. And we're thinking about silica in lots of different environments, but the working environment is that it's quite hot and warm, and you're needing to wear it for 6-7 hours a day, you know. So can a person wear that? Yes. Would me personally likely get very hot and want to take it off and be adjusting it from a comfort point of view? Yes, absolutely. And the likelihood of that, you know, maintaining a seal and me wanting to wear it the whole time is probably going to reduce the longer that day goes on. So thinking about that working environment, what other PPE is being worn as well. So this is where we're getting that suitability in the short time. I've got kind of not enough to really delve into it, but getting you hopefully thinking about, well, gee, I haven't thought about, you know, I'm thinking about the right filter, but what are these other things, how I'm doing, how long that I'm doing it, the environment that I'm doing it, where am I doing it? Am I up a ladder? Am I on scaffolding? Am I in a forklift? You know, they're the suitability that's kind of all interplay with each other. And it's not quite as straightforward as, hey, here's a website with some products or a catalog, wherever you're looking and picking one out, and oh, that's the right filter level, and off I go. To thinking about, you know, in that consultation process and getting the people wearing their respirators involved in, oh, let's work through this, and is this going to be suitable or not, and go through that. So just to highlight, think about a couple of those things that, you know, maybe you haven't thought about before, or maybe reevaluating it or revisiting those things. And this is where you get into the fit side of things. So, you know, that particulate filter, hopefully I've demonstrated that, you know, it's going to filter silica, it's going to filter all these particulates extremely well when we're using, you know, a rated, you know, Australian standards or, you know, internationally standards approved type of product. So we've got that filtration point of view. And you think about those three different circles, then we get to the fit. And fit is honestly the biggest challenge or the biggest variable, because, you know, any manufacturer can make a filter to meet a standard, but how that individual product fits you as an individual or fits your co-workers or, you know, fits anyone is going to be different, because we're all different in that regard. And so here's a whole bunch of different factors when we talk about fit to think about as far as facial hair. I've got a couple of slides after this, but, you know, major dental work, you know, how that face maybe change, if you're getting wisdom teeth out or teeth removed, what is going to impact the face or the fit of that respirator? You know, standard talks about makeup. In the context of, you're probably thinking, why is makeup and respirators linked together in that way? But, you know, thinking for female workforce, maybe it's sunscreen for outdoor workers, anything's going to increase the likelihood of that respirator to move and slip around. We want to be aware of that. That's something we want to think about as well. Training, fitting skill, fitting a respirator is not hard, but there was that example of a picture, and I see lots on social media where they've got a respirator on, they're 99% of the way there, but it all comes crashing down because it's on sideways or upside down, or, you know, haven't got it fitted correctly, even though it is rather straightforward once you know the things that you're looking at as well. Certainly there's an extreme example of facial features from there, but maybe it's a broken nose, maybe it's a scar for whatever reason, but the size of people's heads on the smaller size to the larger size, we're all different. You know, all these things have an impact on fit. I spoke about PPE compatibility before, not that it's impossible to wear all these things at the same time, but once again, put myself in the same position, put yourself in that position as well. Having all these things on your head, certainly you're going to be adjusting, moving, you know, things to try and make it bearable enough for you to do what you need to do. And ideally continue to protect yourself as well. This is when we get into the facial hair side of things. And just to highlight, you know, why do the Australian standards, why do all the international standards, you know, talk about, you know, being clean shaven, free from facial hair when we're talking about these tight fitting respirators that are relying on that seal to provide the protection and make sure all the contaminants are going through the filters, wherever your filter is. That's actually one of my facial hairs from a little project I did a number of years ago to help, you know, have these kind of visuals for these exact purposes of education and webinars and training sessions, to try to visualize. We think about the size of particles, we're talking about respirable crystalline silica, you know, so 10 micron and down, but we start talking about 1 to 2 microns size-wise comparatively from what you're seeing there, you know, where's the most likely leak path? And certainly there's lots of studies that show that the impact of facial hair will significantly reduce the expected level of protection. And this honestly is one of the hardest things for workplaces, thinking about, you know, males and facial hair, they continue to grow. I'm not the biggest fan of shaming that regularly, but, you know, from a protection point of view, it's critical. So I want to talk about this most likely leak path when we align that picture of, you know, the filter and the seal and where things going around. I know the biggest variable, the biggest challenge, the most likely place is going to be that fit and seal point of view as well. And so it's a whole area of the different types of respirators that may or may not be suitable and the reasons why people have facial hair. But I guess just want to highlight the fact that the science is very clear on the impact that facial hair has with tight fitting respirators in that regard. How each workplace goes about it will vary depending on the individual circumstances. So this little sort of chart here, sort of thinking about the different types of facial hair that may be compatible with certain types of respirators. And when we're talking facial hair, we're talking about that sealing surface area of the respirator. So if that hair can be inside the respirator, not impacting where that seal needs to be. So look at a Mr. Mustache there and having a full face respirator where we've got a seal going around the face, that inner orinasal section is more about directing the exhaled breath out of the respirators, that outer seal. So providing it's not impacting on that, that is going to be okay. The reason for the two question marks there is, you know, beards ain't beards. As much as they're still positive pressure products and loose fitting head tops don't need to be fit tested, which we'll touch on, we still can't have big bushy beards flowing out of the respirators, you know, because even that positive pressure, having that more air escaping is going to reduce that pressure. I'm thinking about those high work rates. So certainly the ones on the bottom there, if we can tuck the facial hair beads up into the hood so it's not flowing out of the seal, that's why it very much may be okay. But if you've got someone that just can't fit all their facial hair up inside a hood in that regard, there may be something that isn't going to be suitable for them. So hence why I do highlight that facial hair is a challenge and will always be a challenge in that regard. And this is where we lead into fit testing and what is a fit test. You know, many of you hopefully are familiar with fit testing and many of you have been fit tested, I'm not sure, but just the concept and the idea that, hey, we want to be sure that the respirator that you're given, whatever style, whatever brand it may be, is suitable, compatible, and you can achieve an adequate fit before we go into the environment, as opposed to post, oh, gee, I've been wearing this respirator for X period of time. I'm showing adverse health effects, you know, in the worst case scenario in that regard that, hey, oh, gee, actually the respirator I've got, you know, is the wrong size or just didn't fit me for my characteristics. So this is where we have these methods that is about confirming a process, checking that tight fitting respirator is suitable for the individual, that they can achieve a fit or an adequate seal. And during the pandemic, certainly the question of, hey, what's this fit testing thing? I've never heard of this fit testing thing. What's this new thing that's out there? Fit testing is not new. Certainly from an Australian standards point of view, it's been around for many, many decades. I'm going to show this little video of some fit testing from the 1930s. So we are, you know, 90 plus years from this point in time, and they're doing fit testing. So I'm curious to see what your thoughts are on their fit testing methods. So if I apply this, I'm keen for your thoughts.
Sizes of faces, it had to form a dust-tight seal on all types. The long and narrow, the medium, the round and full. To test security of fit, coal dust was blown into the air. They breathe deeply, trying to suck in all the dust they can. When the respirators are removed, the sharp white line must show not a sign of leakage around the face piece. His face is dirty, but his lungs are clean.
Unfortunately, I can confirm the fit testing methods that we use today in the standards don't pose quite a risk for the fit tester themselves. You're probably thinking, what about the guy who's doing the fit testing? He's the one who's getting the most coal dust exposure. Fit testing lots of people. But just the point, and hopefully you put a smile to your face to appreciate. Certainly we've come a long way, but hey, this concept of fit testing is not new in that regard. Hey, this seal, wherever that seal may sit, is incredibly important when we link it to, you know, that protection of a wearer, individual, whatever the contaminant is. Obviously we're focusing on silica today, but whatever it is, we want it to go through the filters. You know, and this is why, you know, why is fit testing in the standards and mandatory thing? Why are the regulators, you know, really highlighting and enforcing the need as part of your overall control strategy? You know, we're all different, as we've sort of highlighted, you know, confirm, hey, we've selected this brand of respirator, whatever it may be, that, hey, we can achieve, we can get a fit and a seal. And I guess I'll also highlight, you know, a fit test, like I said, confirms a fit can be achieved. It still relies on the individual, comes back to that behavior of the person doing the right thing, wearing what they need to wear, it being conscious of what's happening while they're doing their task, climbing ladders, whatever it may be. You know, and so there's a whole bunch of, you know, reasons. I've got other slides and data about the impact of fit testing, but certainly hopefully what we're chatting about today does highlight, you know, why it is part of the standards, why it is what it is. And I'd say going back, you know, the real change, even though it's been the standards for many years, is, you know, the silicosis in, you know, 2017, 2018, with the regulatory, you know, the blitz on some of the engineer benchtop stone places, to highlighting, doesn't matter the size of the business, you know, a person wearing a respirator, fit is incredibly important. So the types of respirators that do need to be fit tested, the ones that are relying on that tight seal, and that includes both negative pressure and positive pressure. Why positive pressure? I hear you think. We think about the table of all those different protection factors and how high up it went. You know, you think about our SCBA or full face respirators, positive pressure, they have the highest assigned protection factors. And those high assigned protection factors are based on achieving a seal and the positive pressure as well. They're going to be used in the environments where we need to have that greater level of reduction from outside the respirator inside to protect the wearer for those specific environments. This is where we get, you know, the types of respirators that don't require fit testing, those loose fitting positive pressure head tops, because it is relying on that higher volume of air generally with those types of head tops. And that air pushing out, that doesn't mean you can't, you know, you're going to challenge it depending on the airflow and the size, but certainly appreciating, you know, many workplaces look at these types of products to not have to fit test. It sort of takes a lot of the, you know, that ongoing monitoring and maintenance of people and their facial hair levels. It, you know, like I said, PPE takes a lot to do well. When we look at the different types of fit testing methods, and I'm not going to go deep other than to highlight that, hey, there are a couple of different methods that are out there and different companies provide and different equipment you can get, but there's pros and cons with each method. You know, and a big part of what RESFIT is about is trying to, you know, make that information more accessible, more knowledgeable, so workplaces can make a more informed decision about what's going to make the most sense for them. You know, looking at a qualitative, it's going to be a lower cost, more reasonably practical, no power, no calibration in that regard, but it is subjective. We are relying on a person to tell us they can or can't taste, but it's only suitable for half face and disposables. We look at the ambient aerosol condensation nuclei counting fit test method that can fit test the whole range of respirators in full face, half face, filtering face piece as well. And then you've got controlled negative pressure, which is CNC essentially counts particles in the fit testing environment from inside the respirator to outside the respirator. Controlled negative pressure is only suitable for reusable respirators. And it actually, in simple, sucks the air out of the respirator, puts it under negative pressure, and it measures if that seal, that pressure, is being maintained. So if the pressure is then, you know, it's not staying in negative, we know we have a leak. Or a, you know, big leak or a little leak in that regard. So certainly, you know, go visit the RESFIT website, talk to an accredited fit tester about fit testing if you've got any questions, or please do reach out through the Lung Foundation and to myself to help if you've got any questions in that regard. So the person who's doing that fit testing is of incredible importance as well. Now, the ISO standard there, which is going to be adopted as an Australian standard, outlines the different types of evidence or things that a fit tester or a competent fit tester should be able to demonstrate in that regard. And that's essentially what we've based, you know, our RESFIT accreditation program around, is that demonstration and collection of evidence against these different criteria. Now, person is doing the fit testing, it may be an internal person if we're thinking about a larger organization or a smaller organization. It could be an external company that you're engaging to perform that on your behalf, depending on how many people you've got, the types of respirators, lots of different factors that do go into whether you want to tackle it yourself if you're a workplace, or engage someone to do that. If you are looking for fit testers, certainly I strongly, highly encourage you visit the RESFIT website, where you can search for fit testers by location, you know, and hopefully find someone that's fairly close to you or can travel to get to you, depending on where you're based in Australia, of course. There is also approved training providers. So if it is something you're wanting to train up an individual, train up yourself to do fit testing, certainly there's training providers as there, and lots of broad resources broadly around respiratory protection and fit testing as well. So hopefully it's a good place to start. A lot of free information there as well. But certainly that role of the person doing the fit testing is really important. It's easy to do a poor fit test. You know, whether that's a quantitative method, you get a number out of the machine, the CNC machine, but what things impact or influence that number in that regard? So like I said, there's a lot I could go into, but appreciate that want someone that, so that the result of the fit test is a reliable fit test, whether that's a fail or a pass. And the thing I'll probably highlight when you think about, you know, some of them don't like the word fit test because, you know, people think, oh, I failed a test, you know, but a person not passing a fit test is not a reflection on the individual. It is not a reflection on the individual product per se. So think of it like a compatibility thing where, you know, square peg in a round hole type of thing, probably not as obvious as that, but that thing of sometimes just that combination between the individual and their characteristics and that product style size just don't go together. And we want to know that before we put a person in an environment where they're going to be relying on respiratory protection to protect themselves in conjunction with, obviously, ideally, a whole range of other controls as well. So as I sort of wrap this up and bring this up to have a little bit of time for Q&A, is looking at this very terrible example of controls, but obviously helps from a training and education point of view to go, all right, let's look at these individuals here. They're cutting concrete, drilling in there. Certainly is quite dusty. But as we go through those three couple of things from our adequate, suitable, and will it be worn? So, you know, what is the airborne hazard? Now we can see a lot of dust there. So I think it's fairly safe to assume we're going to be concerned about dust. We're cutting concrete. So certainly silica is going to be front of mind, as well as just, you know, concrete dust and other dust, certainly a high burden there, thinking about the amount that we can see there happening. Is there any gases and vapors potentially that's in there as well? Now, you know, what is that exposure level? What is the amount of reduction? So what is that protection factor required? How much reduction do we need? You know, just from a visual check, we're going to say it's high from, you know, from what we're talking about here. So we're going to need a product that's going to have a adequate or a high enough protection factor to bring that exposure down to underneath that workplace exposure standard. Then we think about the suitability side of things. So, all right, we've got lots of products that, you know, may be adequate, but how long are they doing that task for? We've got other types of PPE that's being worn there as well, but hard hat, probably going to be goggles or glasses that are in there. Do we have facial hair concerns for the individuals there? Do they need to talk to each other from a communication point of view? From a thermal load, thinking about, you know, how hot is it there? How long are they expected to do that? So not trying to complicate it, but this is real world stuff as far as there's lots of different things that people are doing and need respiratory protection that we want to think about these suitability things, because if it's not, you know, evaluated in that context, or we're not thinking about how suitable it is, we're just going off the filter and protection factor, I'll pose the question, will it be worn? You know, not knowing, you know, in this situation, if that's, you know, the bulk of the day, there's probably a good chance they're going to want to be taking it off, adjusting it as well. And if they do wearing it, is it only going to be when the safety person's around or the supervisor's around? And obviously we don't want people to wear it just because they're being watched from a compliance point of view, but appreciate, you know, what's the consequences of not wearing that respirator or wearing it correctly. And certainly for any chronic health hazards, it's that challenge to appreciate, you know, I may not feel like much is changing or impact on that, you know, individual basis, but cumulatively it has a huge impact. And certainly with what's come out the last few years, unfortunately, the silica exposure in certain industries, we really got to be getting on top of this. And respiratory protection absolutely is a part of those control strategies. So as we sort of wrap it all up here, you know, appreciating that respiratory protection program, you know, we're talking about selection, but part of that wider system approach to make sure a lot of things are being considered and checked off, and highlighted a couple of things there in bright yellow that, you know, for, you know, have that reliability of PPE does require a whole of organization approach. You know, it's not just here's a respirator, here's a piece of PPE and give it to an individual and, you know, brush your hands off you go, good luck type of thing, but that support and ongoing understanding of what it's like to wear these different types of products in the environments that do need to be there. you know, and thinking about those worker needs and working factors. You know, we're not trying to create a hazard for the individual. You know, certainly I'll talk a lot of workplaces. You look at that particular product that's there with a hose, you know, a lot of times that workers are in tight spaces, a hose like that may introduce a hazard, a catching hazard. So looking at a type of product that is mounted on the head, mounted, you know, maybe more suitable than something like that there. You know, not that that product's a bad product, but understanding that suitability, the applicability of the product and what people are needing to do in their job. And it kind of comes back to a very easy statement, but obviously what is the one that's going to be right for the hazard and being worn the whole time it needs to be worn, you know, and that goes for any type of PPE. So hopefully you've learned a few things today, refreshed a couple of things, confirmed a few things for you. So when it does come to yourself going forward from here and applying some of this information with all the other wonderful information the Lung Foundation is providing its community, certainly you've found it useful and helpful. As I stop sharing there, I'm not sure if there's any questions have come through there now that I can see that there. But yeah, I can take a breath now.
Thank you so much, Mark. It was a very informative and engaging presentation. And I personally loved some of those visuals of what respiratory protective equipment maybe is not. Always a nice reminder.
Not disc scrubbers. As long as people remember that, it's a good starting point, I think.
We'll start there. Yeah, that sounds good. So yeah, we'll move on to the Q&A section and maybe start with some of those pre-submitted questions. And just a reminder to, while you're watching live, to submit any questions you may have so we can answer them while we have Mark here as well. So you definitely answered this throughout the presentation. The question was, how do I ensure my face mask fits properly? But I think I might twist this question a bit to say, like, maybe what are the most common misconceptions around fit testing or the most common mistakes you see in fit testing?
One of the things, I guess, with wearing is, you know, one of the things I didn't touch on is like that user seal check. So fit testing will be a once a year. So standards recommend that it's done annually or, you know, periodically, thinking about, you know, we change in that regard. And appreciating that a respirator may not feel like it's changing as you, you know, bend over, talk. So one of the things with the fit testing with any of the methods is that we're trying to challenge the seal through the fit testing. So just putting it on and going, oh, yeah, that feels pretty good. You know, that doesn't really mean anything. It's not a confirmation of that. Certainly, I use the term best intentions by many workplaces, and I use that qualitative kit, the aerosol taste test, which is the spray into the hood, where, you know, that protocol has been around since the early 1980s. But when you start veering off the process, then that's that reliability. And I'll use that example is part of that process is confirming that the individual can taste the solution. If a person can't taste the solution, you just cannot use that fit test in that regard. And I'll unfortunately talk to workplaces like, oh, yeah, I do the kit, but I don't worry about doing the taste threshold screening process anymore. And it's like, well, hold on a minute. If a person just can't taste it and you're going through the test and they're saying, I can't taste anything, that's what we'd call, you know, a false positive. You know, they're going to walk out thinking, hey, yeah, I'm getting protected, but that's not confirmed, if that makes sense. As far as understanding those finer points, and you know, I'll draw it back to that competent person, whoever that is doing the fit testing, understanding, you know, the process, the method they've chosen, and that protocol is being followed to have confidence in the fit test result, whatever that may be.
Thank you. I think that segues nicely into, like, we know who can be conducting those fit testings, but whose responsibility is it to provide that actual respiratory equipment on work sites?
When we think about, you know, the regulations and about PCBUs or persons conducting a business or undertaking, or in Victoria, I think I still use the employer term, it's going to come down to that workplace as part of their responsibility, you know, that broad duty of care, whether it's, you know, respiratory protection or driving a forklift or operating any kind of machinery, they're going to have that ultimate responsibility to be providing that safe systems of work, safe equipment of work. But appreciating that as an individual or the worker, they also have a responsibility to use those controls that's been provided to them, you know, listen to the training, you know, and, you know, how to fit a respirator and to use it correctly. So it's one thing for, you know, it's dual-sided, you know, workplace obviously has that responsibility, but the individual, and even getting outside what's legally has to happen as far as that. I bring it back to, as the wearer, who doesn't matter what logo is on your shirt, whatever company you work for, we all change jobs through our career, but the individual, the worker, you bear the consequences for not wearing it correctly or not protecting yourself. So often we'll talk about as an individual, you ultimately have the biggest impact of whether you choose what to do, what you don't do, or focus your attention elsewhere, because a workplace can give all the right information. You can be fit tested if you just choose not to do it correctly. So there is that responsibility on the both sides there.
Yeah, that's a really great point. That shared responsibility between both the employer and the employee, and keeping everyone safe. Maybe anecdotally, maybe could you describe the compliance with RPE kind of in everyday work sites? Like when you come across one, are they wearing it? Are they not? Is it slung around their neck?
It's on, half off. Like you see a range of things, certainly with talking to different fit testers, organizations through where I work, in that regard, you go to some places, like any kind of safety program, if it's being supported from the top and resourced and all those kind of things that we know, they're generally going to be in a better spot to have higher compliance, if people know what they're doing and why they're doing it. But on the other end of things, we'll certainly go to workplaces where, I went to a pool manufacturing place years ago, and you can smell the styrene, right? It's a pool manufacturing fiberglassing place. You're expecting that. That's the work environment, and they've got their respirators sitting on the bench, not wearing it. So going back to that compliance kind of thing, you got to wear it. A little story. I usually, a lot of my training, I'll talk about this is before I was with my current employer, and I was working for an occupational hygiene consulting firm, and I was out doing an asbestos monitoring job and I was in a recycling plant. So there's people that are on the sorting line and they had a requirement to wear disposable respirator, thinking of all the stuff that's coming off the stuff being recycling. And this one particular worker, he had one wrapped around his neck, a respirator here, and had one sort of up here on his head as well. And it's like, he was so close, like if it's not there, like whether it's there or whether it's, in your car 2 kilometers away, as a silly example, the same thing's happening. It's not where it needs to be. So I do say that, tongue in cheek about, you got to wear it, but I see examples and many fit testers see examples where they've been provided PPE, but their mind's on something else, and this comes back to that behavior. They've had a tough day with the kids. I've got a 4.5-year-old and sometimes in the morning, my head is in another spot. So I appreciate, people appreciating, we're humans, we've got stuff going on in our life, but why it's that wear time 100% of the time that's needed to wear to have that expected protection and look after yourself and your coworkers.
Yeah. I guess it takes a whole team effort, so to speak, to be like, hey,
and this
that's
is where,
not on right, or you're missing something.
Yeah. I mean, and look, I work for a PPE manufacturer, but I say PPE sucks. It is hard. PPE takes the most amount of effort. When you think about that hierarchy of control, when we are relying on the PPE kind of things, it takes the most effort from an organization because it is that constant things change, people, facial hair, and this is, I say that affectionately, of course, but this is why, PPE is at the bottom. It can be effective, but it relies on all those factors, coming together to, link with reliability, predictability of protection, not just from an individual, from a cohort workplace point of view.
So beautifully summed that up. And I think we might round off with one more question. That was a great note to potentially end on, but I did want to include this one.
We didn't even plan that. Look at that. That worked out well.
Serendipitous. Is there any standardization of fit testing requirements in certain industries or across states? Noting that there's different regulations across states and different areas in general, kind of work health and safety stuff. Does that happen in terms of respirator protective equipment or fit testing?
So when we look at most of the harmonized states, and broadly, Victoria, there's that duty of care when PPE is being issued. That is an appropriate size, comfort, and fit. So that's what the regulations talk about. So when it comes to respiratory protection and, obviously doing a lot of stuff with regulators and being in this particular space, so the way to demonstrate, the accepted way, the accepted, expected way to demonstrate appropriate size, comfort, and fit when it comes to respiratory protection is fit testing. So, you know, that fit testing, you know, falls under that duty of care PPE responsibility as well. And we touched on those few different fit testing methods. Each have their pros and cons, you know. So as far as, you know, the different methods that are in the standard, all are accepted in that context, but obviously some may not be suitable for, you know, you're using a full face respirator, so you just can't use a qualitative method in that regard. So certainly where RestFit has really tried to, you know, help as far as fill that gap of where do I even go to find a fit tester, or what does a competent person fit tester mean? Trying to standardize that benchmark against the international fit testing standards, which will become our Australian standard as well. So hence why, you know, a good reference point for many workplaces when it comes to fit testing as well. Like even looking at I'm conscious of the time, but the Queensland, the recent construction silica code of practice, you know, they've got a whole page on fit testing. Go back 5 years, be one line in the code of practice about fit testing. Now it's a whole section about competence and different methods and the expected things that workplaces are doing are much more spelled out as we're going through this journey. Unfortunately, people, you know, being affected by these different exposures, but we've come a long way in trying to, you know, for workplaces to understand what they need to do, no matter the size of the business, to protect their workers.
A great note to end on as well. So we'll wrap up the Q&A there. So thank you, Mark, for such in-depth and insightful responses and diving a bit deeper into some of those nuances around respiratory protective equipment. And I want to send a thank you to everyone who's attended and engaged with this webinar today. I hope that you were all able to find value in the topic and the presentation. And Mark, on behalf of Lung Foundation Australia, it is always such a privilege to listen and learn from you. So thank you for sharing your expertise with us all today.
Thank you for running these type of events with education. We, you know, there's never enough, you know, so it's fantastic what you're doing. So thank you for allowing me to be involved.
Fantastic. And just a reminder to everyone, this will be, this has been recorded and will be shared with you all. So please share with all your networks to get that such important message out there. And to finally wrap this up, throughout the month of October, Lung Foundation Australia is running our National Silicosis Awareness and Prevention Campaign, Another One Fights the Dust. So we are encouraging workers to take the Healthy Lungs at Work quiz to understand their risk and talk to their GFB about workplace exposure. So go ahead and scan that QR code in the top and it'll bring you to the campaign website where you can complete the Healthy Lungs at Work quiz and access all of our industry specific resources. So that is all from me. I hope everyone has a lovely afternoon. Thank you again, Mark, and bye for now.